For behold, I create new heavens and new earth, and the former shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I create.
Amen.
For behold, I create Jerusalem. I create as a rejoicing, and a people a joy. Verse 19, I'll rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people, and the voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her, nor the voice of crying. No more shall an infant from there live but a few days, nor an old man who has not fulfilled his days. For the child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner, being 100 years old, shall be accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. Can you see the verse there? 22, they shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree, so shall be the days of my people. And my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. 23, and they shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth children for trouble, for they shall be the descendants of the blessed of the Lord, and their offspring with them. 24, it shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they are still speaking, I will hear. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I was reading this, but I want to talk about the prayer that God answers. Because God wants to answer your prayer. A prayer that God answers. When I was reading this, I began to hear this prophecy from Prophet Isaiah. Here it was a promise that was given. God said, now I'm creating a new Jerusalem. Automatically it means there was old Jerusalem. And God said, I'm creating a new Jerusalem. But in that Jerusalem, there will be blessing. From verse 19, you can hear on the second standard of the verse, it says, and joy in my people, and the voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her. You can hear the Bible says, God wants to create a new Jerusalem. But the first one,
Jerusalem,
there was weeping. But on this one, I want to create, there's no more joy, there was no more cry, no more weeping. Read verse 20, it says, there have to be a long life. An infant must live 100 years. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
And also when you build a house, you will stay in it.
And
when you plan, you will enjoy
what you have planned.
But look at verse 24, which I want to concentrate on. It says, it shall come to pass in that new
Jerusalem
that before they call,
before
I will answer. I want to tell you that this has been a serious problem to us Christians. Many times we pray, but we don't see the results. Here God says, before we called in this new Jerusalem, our God will answer. When you are starting to plan to pray,
something will happen.
In fact, this week I want to declare it as a week of prayer. When you speak something before Wednesday comes, I believe you'll be having a testimony. Because if you read there, you will see that always God will be showing that He is aware of our prayers. He knows what we want before we even pray. Therefore, our prayers will be based in thanksgiving this year. Our prayer must be based in saying, "Thank you, Lord, you have done it." What are you going to pray for if before you pray, God does it? What are you going to pray for? You'll be saying, "Thank you, Lord." So in the new Jerusalem of 2019, God wants to answer all your prayers. If you believe, say amen. Like I said, that from the beginning, there was a very serious problem. And it's still around. If we read by the time of Jesus, in John 9, let's go to John 9 from verse 24. If you read 24 to 34, when the blind man's eyes were opened by Jesus, those leaders of the church were not concerned about what happened to the blind man. Their concern was they failed in prayer to bring forth the answers. Remember that the son who was blind, the parents were members of that church. And we know that he was born blind. So their concern was not why his eyes are open. That's why they told this young man and say, "You must give glory to God."
That is why they
knew that it's God who has done it, but not through Jesus. Because if it is done through Jesus, it means they failed in their prayers. So now they were beginning to see competition. And they were afraid, "We have failed this man. There's too much competition in the things of God you don't know. When one man come and pray and God answers, this competition has been there for years. If you want to see another competition, remember that by the time of Elijah, where Elijah says, "We need to prove who is the living God." So the competition of bringing answers has been there for many years. And Elijah said, "Okay, if God is God, follow him. If Baal is God, follow him." And these people went by majority, who were following the prophets of Baal. They began to pray, but nothing happened. I want to tell you that God does not go by majority. And He wants to answer your prayer today.
It's
God who answers prayer. I don't know if
you're
hearing me.
Amen.
And for your God to answer your prayer, you can still pray when you are alone. He will answer you. If you read Matthew 6 from verse 5, can you just read there? You will see what God has spoken. Matthew 6 from verse 5, can you just read for me?
"Also, when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray publicly, standing in the synagogue and on the corners of the street, so that they may be seen by men. I assure you and most solemnly say to you, they already have their reward in full.
Can you just carry on?
But when you pray, go into your most private room.
Yes.
Close the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you
openly.
And
okay, just stop there. If you read Mark 11 verse 1, you will find the disciples coming to Jesus.
Mark 11 1. Retola barutiwa ba yawo Jesu.
Luke 11 verse 1, yes.
Luke 11 verse 1.
The disciples, they came to Jesus and says, please, can you teach us, teach us how to pray as John the Baptist taught his disciples. Because when they came, they were aware of what was happening to Jesus. Why when Jesus prayed, get answers? He said, okay, they went to say, please, say, we have seen you opening
the
can you just teach us how to pray? John also taught his disciples, meaning that prayer is for everyone. You are called to pray. The disciples are called to pray. Here, prayer is not for apostles. So when they reach there, in Matthew 6:5, you could hear Jesus was trying to say, don't pray like these Pharisees. They are hypocrites. They want to be seen by people. And when you pray, enter your closet. Jesus was beginning to teach them there how to pray. And he showed them as they pray for the kingdom. They must pray the same way when they pray, when they ask for their food. When they pray and say, oh, thy kingdom come. It must be the same way when they pray, when they ask bread of every day. Already you could see that Jesus was teaching them to pray always. He said, pray for everyday bread. Meaning that every day you must pray. Also, you must pray for the kingdom to come. And show them, you cannot pray unless you forgive someone. It sums up in the issue of whatever you want people to do for you, do to them. Jesus shows them because they were concerned. They were watching him when he was healing people. They were seeing him when he was stopping the storm. The cripple were walking. They had right to see that this man, always God answered him. And he began to teach them how to pray. That's why I say, you need to learn how to pray. A prayer that brings forth answers. Can you just ask somebody how many times you were fasting? And how many results you have received? This is your lesson today. If you read Matthew 17:14-21, the disciples failed one time. They came to Jesus and there were many people around them. There was a child that was sick who had epilepsy. And then this father took the child to the disciples. When now Jesus came, he found people were standing looking at the disciples. But the disciples were failing to bring the answer. It was a shame to Jesus. Because he taught them everything. It dishonors God when you don't receive what you are praying for. But it glorifies God when you receive what you are praying for. When Jesus reaches there, he said, what are you doing with them? And the man spoke, I brought my son. But your disciples failed to
heal.
Listen to this. I'm concerned about some unanswered prayers. This does not bring the glory of God for us. Our God is not glorified. Today, I want to give you utterances. So that when you pray, it will be like God speaking. And you will receive of what you are praying for. And if you believe, say amen. The Bible says, Jesus said, where is the child? If you could read there, you will see that Jesus was not happy at all. Bring that child to me. He said a statement that I want to say to you. How long am I going to be with you? In other words, Jesus was saying, why are you failing to reach to grow up to maturity? I taught you this and you are failing to be mature. I taught you this. How long must I teach you? When he cast the demon, when they come to ask him, he told them, but this kind, he carried on teaching them. He said, I know you have been casting demons, but also if you want to have a prayer with answers, you must also involve fasting.
He
said there are some kinds that need fasting. I don't know if you're hearing that. One time when I was in the
U.S.,
I just heard someone say, I'm in fasting. But he was eating, so I was concerned. You know, in the U.S., people can do fasting, but they can say, I'm fasting meat. But they eat bread, their stomach will be full. Others, they can fast, bread. They can fast bread. They eat meat, they enjoy it. But if we can learn about the fasting, then you'll see that Jesus did a dry fasting. I don't know if you're hearing me. Jesus did a dry fasting. And sometimes you will just get a fasting when the disciples were not even aware. If you remember the story of a seeker in Sychar, where he kneeled there and disciples knew he was hungry. Because they understood that he has not eaten anything. They went to buy food. When they came with food, he said, I've got a work to do. I've got food that I eat. When I do that work, I'm eating food. It's part of the fasting. I'm praying that you learn this fasting. This week, you go for fasting. I know another fasting. The one that was done by Esther. If you read Esther 4, go and read all of it.
Esther 4,
Esther said, I know it's impossible to go to the king. It's impossible. But go and tell Mordecai that we can take 3 days fasting. And already Mordecai was in fasting. But the fasting of Mordecai was a wrong fasting. Because he took dust, he put in his head. Everybody was aware that he's in fasting. I don't know if you're hearing me. And he says, let's go for this prayer. She knew that if she went, she can go through this prayer, she can approach the impossible and come out with a miracle. I'm just praying today that you listen to this. We need to be Christians who add fasting in our prayers to get the results. I can see God want to answer your prayers. I'm in fasting now, and I'm telling your situation to change, and God is answering me now. I say your situation is changing. If you believe, say it's changing. Say in the name of Jesus. Look at Abraham. If you read Genesis 24 verse 1, it says Abraham was old and well stricken in age, and the Lord has blessed him in all things. Can you see that verse there? What happened to Abraham? He was a man of prayer. If you read Genesis 18 from 17 to 33, Abraham took all his time and he prayed when he had the mind of God and said, God, don't destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. In Genesis 18 verse 17 to 33. The moment Abraham learned the plan of God, he went for prayer. It's not only Abraham, even Daniel. After Daniel read scriptures, he went for prayer. You know, sometimes you don't just need to pray. Your prayer must be guided by the scriptures, and God will answer you. Abraham learned.
Abraham,
if you remember, the Bible says Abraham is about to be big. And God said, we cannot hide anything from him. Let's tell him. This subject Abraham in prayer. He went to pray. He went for fasting. He went to pray and say, God, you cannot destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. If, what about if he can find the righteous? The Bible shows that he went down, he was trying to battle with God. Already the word was uttered, but he carried on praying, and God answered. I don't know if you're hearing me. Let's read. We will see that in 1 Thessalonians 5, 17 to 18.
5:17-18.
One of our problem why God is not answering our prayers. When we pray, we don't pray without ceasing. Sometimes we just pray until we found what we found and we stopped. But if you read verse 18. It says what? In everything,
in every situation,
no matter, you must give thanks. Can you just read, Mama, verse 18?
In every situation, no matter what the circumstances, be thankful and continually give thanks to God.
Listen to this. Many times we want to change everything by prayer, isn't it? In the process, when we are busy praying, we must also give thanks. Thank you, Lord, for what I'm going through. Thank you, Lord, for what I'm going through. The person who thanks God of his situation is a person who has got a happy heart, because he knows that God will change the situation. You cannot say thank you if you don't know the answer. I don't know if you're hearing me. He who say thank you has already received. Here the Bible says, in every situation, if you say thank you Lord for this situation, you already say thank you Lord that you have received an answer. You are uttering that you have already received an answer. Here you find that we pray, but when the problems start to be worse, we stop. And we change our prayer item. I don't know if you're hearing me. You pray for business. And when business is not doing it, you start to pray for a job. Oh God, give me any job. Sometimes Christians, they love to pray for a specific job. It's when they think they are early. But when they feel like time is going, they begin to say any job or God. It's when they are looking at their circumstances and their situations. And the Bible says you must thank God for that situation. Let me try to tell you maybe what you don't know. Our God is aware of everything. If he's not answering you, he knows the reason why he's not answering you. If he answers you, and there are people around you who are supposed to kill you, and you are calling them friends, they will kill you. God sometimes, he can take you in the dark, and the wrong people will leave you, and he answers you. Our God doesn't want anybody to know your genesis. I don't know if you're hearing me. Tell you about our God does not want anyone to claim your genesis.
Or a claim over Arikia,
listen, those who think they are helping you, they are doing nothing. Sometimes we reach a point where we tell people and say they are helping us.
They know they are doing nothing.
When they give you that money, they have given you nothing. You need to reach a level whereby you trust God. If he's not giving you, call it a wrong prayer. Begin to thank God for your situation. Because out of that situation, there will be results that you need. Even the situation itself is prayer. It's part of your prayer. When you acknowledge God by the situation you're going through, it becomes a prayer for you. And the wrong people will leave you, and the right people will come. I'm praying that when you pray today, you will have the results of your prayers. If you believe, shout hallelujah. In Acts 12 verse 5, when Peter was in prison, prayer was made without ceasing. They prayed and prayed and prayed. They prayed and thanked God that Peter is in prison, and God, you are the only one who can remove it. Not long I found that people are not praying, they use the mistakes of others and take advantage of them. Any challenge you go through, they challenge, use it to climb on top of you. I don't know if you're hearing that. But if you pray, there is something that is supernatural that will happen. Some things we call the blessings are cursed in disguise. Listen to this. You can pray for what you need, and you focus on it until God opened doors. I don't know if you're hearing me. Don't just take anything and call it blessing. Peter was in prison.
Petro na le kholegong.
And the church could not stop.
Kereke ya setuelo thapela.
I don't know what is in prison in your life.
Na ke tsebo re ke eng e kholegilweng ka re bophelo jwa lena.
Don't stop praying. God will answer you.
Thapela ngwana bo mma modimo ta fetola.
Tell somebody God want to answer me.
O botsa motho leng ga fere modimo nyo kompetola.
I won't stop praying.
Na nka setuelo
God will answer me.
Modimo ta mphetola.
I know that if I pray and you pray, God will answer us. I don't care any situation. I know that if you pray, the will of God will be done. I don't know if you're hearing that. Sometimes we look at our challenges and we ask God why. I want to tell you today that there's a prayer today that will offer. I see the prison doors open. I see the prison doors open. Do you know that this church was praying? It was non-stop, but they were already losing hope. When Peter came back, after God saved him, when he reached the door, when he knocked, when the girl called Rhoda, went to open the door, and when she found that it's Peter, I'm surprised why she did that. She didn't open the door, she closed the door. In other words, she was shocked. She ran back and said, there is Peter there. He's at the door. They say, you are crazy. But they are the ones who are praying. Sometimes you pray and pray, but you are hopeless. I want to tell you that if you pray, you reach a level where you are hopeless. Know that it was a time of God answering you. Don't give up. Carry on praying. Don't give up. Carry on praying. Can you ask your neighbor, did you reach a state of hopeless? It's a right state of an answer. It's a right state of an answer. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hebrews 4:16. Let's read that verse. I think I'm talking too much. I just want to read verses here. Yeah, let's read.
He says one more,
Hebrews 4:16.
Therefore,
yes,
let us with privilege approach the throne of grace, that is the throne of God's gracious favor, with confidence and without fear, so that we may receive mercy for our failures and find his amazing grace to help in time of need. An appropriate blessing coming just at the right moment.
I want to tell you that this scripture is not different with the one that says, he who comes to God must believe he is. And he is the rewarder of those who seek him
diligently.
If you read this one, you will see that God needs your faith, your confidence. Sometimes you just reach a level where you say, I know God is going to answer me
on this.
You know, it just reminded me David. When he was facing Goliath. He had nothing to show that can prove that he can defeat Goliath. But he had this faith, confidence, and say, I'm approaching you,
Goliath,
in the name of Jehovah. I know what happened. You see, I've killed the bear. I've killed the lion. What about you? That is confidence. When everybody was afraid, he had confidence. All these past years, if I'm praying for you, I'll pray for you with confidence. I don't care your situation. If I'm laying my hands on you, I know you'll come back with the testimony. I don't know if you're hearing me. You know, if you reach a level where you believe God, and say, this year I want to see myself driving a car like this, and you build up that confidence, God will reward you. One of our problems is when challenges rises, when we start to see a shadow of death, a valley of shadow of death, fear comes. Sometimes we look at our situation. We even ask God, why is he allowing
this?
The Bible says God is able in Ephesians 3:20. Ephesians 3:20 is able to do above what you think, above what you ask. Put something in your mind. Say it out. And something will happen. Have confidence. You need to have confidence of saying, I'm going to be used by God. I'm going to be rich. I believe God. Poverty will come to test what you say. But you carry on praying it out. It's as good as what Jesus said. Whoever say to this mountain, be casted out. Go to the sea. You will see it happening. It's confidence. You speak it out. You pray it out. Until you see it. Before you pray from now, because most times we make mistakes, come to God with confidence. Don't rush to open your mouth and speak. Build that confidence by thanking God. Praising him. When you are quiet there, Holy Spirit will bring something that you need to say. And whatever you say, you say it. I don't know if you're hearing me. But most of the time, we pray out of fear. Oh God. If no one gives me money to pay rent, what is it that people will say? That's why God is not answering. Sometimes the Bible says we are asking him to spend in our desire. That's why he doesn't answer. We are focusing in our own desire. In
Jacob 5:13.
James says, if anyone is suffering,
among you,
pray. All of us, we are suffering here. Is it true? Suffering from one way or the other. Prayer is supposed to be our life. Ask your neighbor, what are you suffering of? How far are you praying? And your answer is what? If you are suffering, pray. Suffering is a very good thing to channel us in prayer. Many prayer warriors were born out of suffering. If you want to see God raising people,
do
you want to see God raising people in South
Africa?
Let's allow our rent to be zero. I went to Nigeria in Osun State.
Nigeria Osun State.
When I was there, in Nigeria, those people were suffering. No time to watch TV. In the morning, even the old people, they climb the mountain. In the evening, they are coming back. They eat once. Since you wake up, you've eaten a lot. Isn't it? I mean, some people, you know, they suffer climbing the mountain. Evening, they are coming back. Old people. I asked that man, he said, this is the life here. Even now we have got giants in the gospel in Nigeria. We've got giants because of suffering. How can you suffer this mubango? There's days of our lives. You're always watching TV. Not time of prayer, isn't it? Others are waking up. They go. Can you see what is happening in Zimbabwe? They will be warriors. People will wake up and go to the mountain. When you suffer, you must pray. But don't wait when you have got empty. When you are empty. Don't wait when you lose everything. Can you just pray like you have got nothing? And you will receive everything. I don't know if you are hearing me. How many of you want to pray this? God wants to answer you. Pray like you have got nothing. Don't pray like you have got something. There was a time when I was used to go to the bush. I know bush. I know bush, pray in the bush. And I had nothing. And when I reached there, I never checked where I'm sleeping. One day I decided to go to the bush. I began to ask myself, what am I going to take to put it down so that I lie on it? And I said, it means now my prayer is changed. I have to go the same way I used to go. Is to pray without ceasing. Is to pray normal in the same level you were praying. I don't know if you hear me. I see your suffering coming to an end. I see your suffering coming to an end. Are you going to pray? Can you ask your name? Are you going to pray? And how is your prayer life? Ask your neighbor, how is your prayer life? Some of you know Popeye too much. Some of you read newspapers too much. He who wants to pray must quote scriptures. Let me show you here. In the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy 3:17. When you pray scriptures, the scriptures will make you perfect. Thoroughly finished unto good works. If you want to have good works, you want to be blessed, pray through scriptures. Quote the word of God. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
And God will answer your prayer. God wants to answer someone here. When you say in the name of Jesus, something will happen. Ever say in the name of Jesus, I want to see this, it happens. I'm giving you 3 days. I was giving you these 3 days. Just take one day. And say, I want to see something. And you will see something. We serve God who answers prayer. Look at Isaiah 58. And I will be closing very soon. Verse 9. Can you just read Isaiah 58:9?
Isaiah 58:9.
God answers prayer. Today, he must answer you here. Can you read, Mama?
Okay.
Verse 9.
Then you will call and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help and he will say, here I am. If you take away from your midst the yoke of oppression, the finger pointed in scorn towards the oppressed or the godly, and every form of wicked, sinful, unjust speech. 10. If you offer yourself to assist the hungry and satisfy the need of the afflicted, then your light will rise in darkness and your gloom will become like midday.
Okay. You can hear that. God says, when you call, I will answer. But he gave you conditions. Can you just read again that verse 9, Mama?
Then you will call and the Lord will answer.
Yes.
You will cry for help and he will say, here I am. If you take away from your midst the yoke of oppression, the finger pointed in scorn toward the oppressed of the ungod, of the godly,
yes,
and every form of wicked, sinful, unjust speech.
Yes. The how you talk.
Kamkhovulelang.
Taking away these wrong things. This scripture is no different with Isaiah 59 verse
1.
Where God says, my hand is not shut. My ear is not deaf.
Hear
it from 1 to 3.
Amen.
Till since. You cannot expect God to answer you when you are sinning. Bring justice. Be a righteous person. When you pray, God will answer you. Today, I believe, when you are going to pray prayer, I'm expecting answers here. Not somewhere here now. Are you ready to see answers? Are you ready to bring answers here?